The next item of business is a debate on motion 11036 in the name of Maurice Golden on supporting communities to mitigate flooding impacts and increase resilience. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Maurice Golden to speak to and move the motion. Up to 13 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. Storm Babbitt has left a terrible trail of destruction in its wake, and the north-east of Scotland, Perthshire and Tayside have been hit especially hard. There was widespread damage to infrastructure, families were evacuated from their homes, and tragically, people lost their lives. We're joined today in the gallery by Councillor Gavin Nicholl and other residents from Brechin who have been affected by this flooding, because it's on that personal level where the real impact of the storm is being felt, by the individuals who have been left to pick up the pieces. So, let me tell you something of those people who fear their plight might be too easily overlooked, such as in Milton of Finavon, where I visited last week. Most people in the chamber or watching at home won't have visited there, but they will have driven past it. It's a hamlet of 25 homes and is adjacent to the busy A90 between Forfar and Brechin. That road became one source of flooding from the runoff. On one side of the village, there is a Lemno Burn, which is now a river, and on the other is the River South Esk. Both breached their banks during Storm Babbitt, effectively meaning the small village was being assaulted from all sides. The effect was devastating, with the River South Esk surging through farmers' fields, destroying crops and wrecking homes. The devastation was massive and deeply distressing. I met a family who had only just moved into their home in February, but now all their appliances, their furniture and their kitchen were destroyed. What's left of their possessions have been bundled into their car while they search for a rental property. Another resident had to leave their home a year ago and were due to move back in last month before being flooded again. Another family, forced from their home by the flood water, faced the additional stress of the temporary accommodation, being unable to accommodate their disabled children who require specialist equipment. I could go on and on with more heartbreaking stories, and sadly, these experiences are common throughout Angus and beyond. But what would help these people now is action, both in dealing with the aftermath of the storm and also to mitigate the damage for future storms. Both are issues in their own right now, so let me deal with each in turn. At the outset, I want to express my admiration for the emergency services and local authority staff who worked incredibly hard in treacherous conditions and at risk to themselves to preserve life and support the most vulnerable in our communities. I also want to commend the efforts of utilities and other services to restore power systems, repair infrastructure and reopen transport links. The question now, though, is what help will be provided to those affected who are now faced with trying to rebuild their lives? I appreciate the First Minister has already pledged support during his visit to see the damage in Brechin. It was right that he came to see the town because Brechin was one of the worst affected. Record levels of flooding caused the local river to swell a staggering 4.4 metres above normal levels, overwhelming the recently installed flood defences and forcing the evacuation of more than 350 properties. Some residents won't be able to return to their homes before Christmas, perhaps longer, while others might not be able to return at all. But while the First Minister pledged support, he didn't confirm how much, understandably, at that stage. But let me be clear, this is one of the costliest weather events in Scottish history, with a repair bill that could hit £500,000. So it's a fair question to ask for the detail of how much and how long support will be provided for. Those forced out of their homes or counting the cost of ruined businesses face months of disruption. The fear they have is the warm words coming from politicians will have no follow-up, and I've already heard such concerns on adaptation measures. That echoes the Committee on Climate Change's findings last year that progress on climate change adaptation had stalled, with flooding amongst the worst areas assessed. To be fair, the Scottish Government has accepted the need to do more, such as the need for better evidence, monitoring and evaluation. I hope they will show the same willingness today and listen to opposition calls to take further action to mitigate the risks from future storms. Those risks include damage to infrastructure, transport and energy systems, but with the added danger that future incidents of coastal erosion and flooding become more frequent. In their Scottish emissions report last December, the CCC pointed out that, compared with 30 years ago, Scotland's winters have become wetter and the sea level around our coasts has risen between 10 millimetres and 30 millimetres per decade, increasing problematic places such as Montrose. October is already the wettest month on record for some parts of Scotland, with almost a foot of rain falling. At the start of the month, we saw extensive flooding across Aviemore, Argyll and Perth, which I'm sure colleagues representing those areas will discuss in more detail. And then, of course, towards the end of the month, we had Storm Babet. The same CCC report warns that further climate change in Scotland is inevitable, no matter how rapidly global greenhouse gas emissions are reduced. Now, that doesn't mean it's not important to reduce emissions. In fact, it's vital we do to avoid even worse climate change effects. But we must combine our net zero efforts with adaptation measures to protect ourselves from the risks already on the horizon. An obvious start would be to look at floodplains. This wasn't fully developed in the National Planning Framework 4, and a long-term goal should be to assess the impact of such development. River basin management should also be reviewed. Back in June, the Net Zero Secretary stood here and declared she had, and I quote, absolute confidence in the current plans. That was despite the CCC having pointed out more than a year earlier that there was no adaptation actions in the plan. I think we can all agree those plans could do with a review. We should also keep support options under review to ensure at-risk properties can still access insurance cover. And we can help reduce insurance costs by looking at how to make home adaptations easier for people. Alongside which, we consider where actions such as dredging might deliver flood protection benefits that outweigh potential environmental impacts. We also need to consider what more can be done to support local authorities and partner agencies in the immediate response to these storms. Yes, there is Belmont scheme to support councils dealing with emergencies, but that's activated against the backdrop of years of cuts from the Scottish Government that have left local authority finances in tatters. So I hope ministers will give consideration for our calls for local climate resilience funds to be deployed in the event of severe weather. They could also look at how to improve provision of emergency and temporary shelters, including those suitable for people with disabilities. At the most basic level, local authorities should have a good supply of sandbags, but I've been hearing from people on the ground in Angus who say they were issued with just 2 sandbags per property. That's clearly inadequate and suggests a need for better coordination of resources between low and high risk areas during an emergency. Happy to.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr Gove for giving way and I'm appreciating the contents of his speech. I wonder if he sees, as part of this particular point that he's making, a role for community resilience groups to be strengthened and supported to ensure that there is a formidable presence on the ground in all communities which can work collaboratively with public sector organisations in the event of such incidents.
Horace Gordon.
I wholeheartedly agree with the member because it's actually the people on the ground that know the properties that are most likely to be affected rather than a council or another agency, and it's certainly there for communities to be resourced to help protect themselves. It also plays into a wider concern I've seen in local communities that there's insufficient leadership from the Scottish Government. As I touched upon earlier, there's a view that ministers turn up, listen sympathetically, and then leave it to the local authority to sort things out. Well, that can't work because water flows and flooding are beyond the scope of any one local authority or organisation. For example, is a cash-strapped council going to instigate measures that, while needed, only benefit communities in another local authority? Or at an individual level, how are householders to understand how adapting their property might affect flood impacts downstream? The best way to manage these risks is to bring together all the key players and work to a strategic plan to mitigate flood damage across Scotland as a whole. That's why we're calling for a multi-agency task force led by the Scottish Government. It could provide the strategic direction that seems to be lacking and could direct adaptations, guidance and resources to where they are most needed. I note the Scottish Government is committed to the next flood resilience strategy, bringing together new partners. So I hope they can take that commitment to its logical conclusion with a strategic element. Any efforts to build up our resilience and adapt to future storms must involve our food-producing community. They know the land, they know what works, and they know just how bad it could get if we don't take action. The flooding at the start of the month had already caused millions of pounds worth of damage to crops, and Storm Babbitt has heaped more misery on our food producers. The NFUS was already warning some farmers won't be able to absorb the costs, and wafer-thin profit margins won't allow farmers to keep withstanding future floods. I urge the Scottish Government to provide them with the direct support now and to explore what more can be done to invest in food producer-led adaptation measures that benefit us all, whether it's food producers, families or local firms. What they all want from the Scottish Government is leadership, a multi-agency task force. Yes, they need support in the here and now to clean up and repair, but they need some hope that there is a plan to make sure the next time doesn't hit as hard.
Thank you. I now call on Mary McCallum to speak to and move Amendment 1103.6.2. Up to 9 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to respond for the Government on this most important issue today. Storm Babbitt was an exceptional weather event for Scotland with some terrible and at times tragic consequences. To all members in the Chamber and indeed to our guests who join us in the gallery, I want to be absolutely clear that we are committed to supporting those who are impacted by Storm Babbitt. As with all exceptional events, we are also committed to learning every lesson that is possible from both our response and recovery. Before proceeding to the substance, I should like to begin by offering my heartfelt condolences to the families and to the friends of the individuals who tragically lost their lives in Storm Babbitt. They are mourning the loss of a loved one in tragic circumstances, and my heart is with them. Likewise, I wish to express my continuing sympathy for those whose homes and businesses have been impacted. I know very well, personally, but also on a constituency basis, how traumatic the experience of flooding is, the fright of the experience as it unfolds, but equally the stress and the uncertainty of the aftermath. And again, my heart goes out to them. I must also begin by recognising that Storm Babet was met with an impressive response by emergency service providers, local authorities, community groups and other resilience partners. Often working in extremely difficult conditions, these groups ensured that help and support was available for those who needed it, and we were very grateful for their dedicated efforts, and I'm sure everyone in the Chamber would wish to join me in thanking them, and I expect we will hear that echoed throughout contributions today. And I think, Presiding Officer, I am confident speaking so fulsomely about that coordinated and impressive response because I was able to witness it firsthand and on an ongoing basis through meetings of the Scottish Government Resilience Operations, which were chaired by ministers right throughout the severe weather event. During media interviews in the midst of the storm, actually it was in the morning following the water levels breaching, flood defences in Brechin, I noted that Scotland's preparation had been early, that Scotland had been coordinated in response, and that we would be coordinated in our recovery, and I repeat that commitment today. Scottish Government resilience meetings took place on the 18th, 19th, 20th and 21st, and I was able to attend them all. I saw firsthand how the Met Office, how SEPA, Police Scotland, other emergency responders, our utilities companies and, crucially, our local resilience partnerships, among many others, were working determinedly to both prepare and deliver in a coordinated way, and always with the welfare and the best interests of our communities at the heart of their work. And of course, the storm and its impacts, they ended up being as severe as the Met Office and SEPA and Police Scotland had advised, particularly within that red warning area. As Maurice Golden noted last week, the First Minister visited Brechin. He met with residents, he engaged with the local community, and he took the opportunity to set out that the Scottish Government stood ready to provide support throughout recovery. Subsequently, the Minister for Local Government Empowerment and Planning visited Montrose and Brechin this Monday to gain a better understanding of the scale of the impact on the local communities and how the Scottish Government can best help. And my colleague Mary Goujon has been visiting food producers impacted by both of October's storms. Now, yes, happy to.
Sarah Boyack.
Last week I asked when the Scottish Government would actually carry out an analysis to review existing and planned flood prevention infrastructure in the light of Storm Babet. Could you give us a timescale for that today, Cabinet Secretary?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's an ongoing process. The Member's absolutely right to raise it. It's an ongoing process on a number of fronts, not least, I think, most of all, in respect of SEPA's flood forecasting, a very important tool, but obviously it has to be adapting to both the increasing risk of climate change and indeed to really practical things like the flood defence in Brechin being compromised. So that work is ongoing, and I'll speak more about that in today's debate. I'll give way to Mr. Swinney.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and I'd like to follow the point that Sarah Boyack has raised, because in the work that SEPA are undertaking to examine future forecasting levels, can I make a plea for that work? I'm certain this will be the case, that work takes into account the very dramatically different set of circumstances that we have all experienced in the course of the last few weeks, and it cannot be written off as some isolated incident. It has to reflect the circumstances have to be reflected in future policy on a whole variety of different questions, flooding and planning, for example, or we will simply be turning a blind eye to a significant change in circumstances that's affected our country.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very happy to give John Swinney a concrete assurance that this will not be regarded as an isolated incident. I think it is not wise to attribute one weather event ever to climate change, but we know that extreme weather events like this are exacerbated by climate change, and that climate change is an increasing threat, and it will be absolutely incumbent upon SEPA and on planning policy development across a range of matters to be cognisant of that, and I can assure Mr. Swinney of that. Presiding Officer, the process of assessing the full damage caused by Storm Babet, it will take time. Maurice Golden reflected that. Further rainfall since the event has made this task more difficult. However, we know that the scale of the damage and disruption has, of course, been significant and that we are on a long road to recovery. But as my government colleagues have already set out, and I wish to reiterate today, we will continue to support our partners to ensure that communities can recover as well and as quickly as possible. I'm going to make progress because I'm a bit concerned about time, but I'll be glad to take points during the debate. In that regard, and I'm just going to use the time that I have left to set out some of the immediate responses that we have taken. On Tuesday, 24th of October, at the first Cabinet meeting following the storm, Cabinet discussed the impact and agreed that a Scottish Government task force would be set up to coordinate for our part the recovery phase. And in furtherance of this, the Cabinet Secretaries, including myself, we met with senior officials in relevant policy areas on Monday this week to receive a sit rep on relevant issues and to discuss the beginnings of that task force. So I agree with Maurice Golden on his point about a task force, and I can assure him that development of the same has been underway since last Tuesday. I'm afraid I'm keen to make progress. We know that local recovery plans are being drawn up and are being delivered through Vital Partnership Working. The Scottish Government stands ready to support these partners. And by way of practical support, a very important first step came when the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance agreed the activation of the Belwyn Scheme on Tuesday, 24 October. The scheme exists to give special financial assistance to councils that are facing undue financial burden as a result of large-scale emergencies. And to date, six local authorities have notified the Scottish Government of a potential claim, and we will work with them to progress this. Otherwise, the Scottish Welfare Fund and crisis grants that come from it are also available to families and people in Scotland who are on low incomes and who have been hit by crisis such as a flood. These can be applied for through local authorities, and I would encourage people to apply. And should they be looking for support in that regard, they can work with the Scottish Flood Forum, who undertake with local communities and recovery partners that really important support work on the ground. I'm very grateful for the work that they have been doing since we began funding them in 2009, but importantly, in response to this event, members of the forum have been involved with local communities, and two members of the team have been based in Brechin this week, offering free advice and information to almost 100 residents already on issues such as recovering from flooding and supporting insurance claims. And I've already noted how my...
The Cabinet Secretary must conclude.
I've noted how my colleague, the Rural Affairs Secretary, is engaging with Food Producers Impact and has already committed to funding support for the repair of flood banks. Presiding Officer, I have tried to use my opening slot to set out some of that immediate operational support that we're putting in place. I'll be very glad to hear members' contributions throughout the debate, and I will try and mention in my closing remarks some of the strategic forward-looking work that we'll be undertaking in response to this. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I call the next speaker, I'd just be grateful if all members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call Sarah Boyack to speak to and move amendment 11036.1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week's statement on Storm Babbitt did give us all the chance to send our condolences to the families who'd lost a loved one, to thank those in our public services who worked so hard to rescue people and support communities. But as has been observed already in the first two speeches, the floods have had a devastating impact on people's homes, their businesses, their farming communities. So we really need to do two things. Firstly, support those who've been affected, because it could be months before people are able to live in their homes again. And secondly, we need to urgently learn lessons from this devastating incident. So, Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name. It's an add-on amendment, as I want it to be constructive, but also to highlight concerns about the need for action. Last week, I pointed out that the Brechin scheme was only built 7 years ago and was designed to deal with a 1 in 200 years incident. So we do need to know urgently from the Cabinet Secretary about clarity on what work is being done to review existing and planned flood prevention infrastructure, because that needs to be reflected, what worked during Storm Babbitt, crucially what didn't work, but what will also be done to accelerate flood resilience to support communities, businesses and farmers. It's disappointing, I think, that the Scottish Government wants to delete the recommendation for a multi-agency task force, because it is important that we have a collaborative approach, but that we also have a regional approach. So the Scottish Government and local authorities to work across boundaries, that's going to be crucial given the scale of the potential change we see. In our amendment, we highlight the fact that the Scottish Government has failed to report on progress on flood risk management plans as required by the 2009 Flood Risk Management Scotland Act. So we need more political leadership, and we need that progress report. So I hope in our concluding remarks, the Cabinet Secretary will give us that clarity. We need the expertise, and we need people to come together with an investment and action now. So I do think that means a partnership approach between the Scottish Government, local councils, businesses and farming stakeholders, but also the transport sector and environmental campaigners. We need people with experience in the room together. As the motion rightly states, we are likely to see more frequent and more intense extreme weather events, such as the storms that are fuelled by climate change. That could mean forest fires, drought, flooding in urban and rural communities, as well as the impact of sea level rise. And that could put people's lives and livelihoods at risk, damaging homes and buildings, vital infrastructure, agricultural land, our natural habitats, and damage which could put our cultural heritage beyond repair. The Scottish Fire and Rescue, if it's very brief, yes.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful, Member, giving me just on the point you made there. We know that prolonged water scarcity, particularly before these big storms, can have a significant impact on flood conditions, with impacts like soil compaction. To what extent do you think this, the impacts of drought should be considered within a flood management plan?
Sarah Boyack.
Well, it's got to be a joined-up approach to tackle extreme weather conditions, because that's the experience in other countries as well. So the member is right, it's floods and it's droughts. And it's extended extreme weather periods. It could be storms. We need to be prepared for the combination of these impacts. The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service say that 1 in 22 of all residential properties in Scotland are at risk of flooding from rivers, the sea or heavy rainfall. And by 2050, it's estimated that the annual cost that floods will have upon UK businesses could exceed £1 billion. So it's a now issue. We need to do the heavy lifting now to build resilient infrastructure that protects our biodiversity, uses our natural environment to mitigate the impact of flooding, and to deliver crucial adaptation projects to deal with the change that is already here or is coming. Now, the Government's amendment states its intention to produce a national flood resilience strategy for Scotland. I do think it's fair to ask why we don't yet have one. We've passed two climate acts and a flood risk management act years ago, so it does feel we're behind where we need to be. I want to finish on the second part of our amendment today, though, because it's about having a fire and rescue service that has the resources and capability to support communities and save lives in times of crisis. The Scottish Government needs to be worried that 93% of FBU members agreed or strongly agreed with the statement that the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service is not adequately resourced enough to deal with the increase in climate-related incidents such as wildfires and flooding. The firefighters I spoke to at the FBU rally last week were clear. They're already pushed to the limit. I spoke to one firefighter who said that he'd had to do 20-hour shifts, and that's not uncommon. That's not safe for him or the colleagues he is working with or the people whose lives he is working to save. And during Storm Babbitt alone, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service took over 750 emergency 999 calls and attended almost 300 incidents. So we've got to see that acknowledgement that came in the FBU's Firestorm report that water rescue sources are regularly unavailable due not to enough competent crew being available. So we need to get that investment. And the SFRS stated earlier this year that a cut of £11 million from its budget, appliances had to be withdrawn, including one at Polmadee, which provided a dedicated water rescue service. That's putting us into reverse, less resilient, more prone to disasters, and not taking seriously the impact of climate change. So with 1 in 22 homes at risk, firefighters who don't believe they're adequately resourced to respond to flood and emergency events, we have a disaster waiting to happen again. We need action. It's current crisis. Appliances used in times of flooding are being withdrawn now, leaving communities without protection. When the next severe flood comes and the rescue services are not just cut to the bone, they've been cut beyond repair, what happens to those communities? We need to act now. invest in our key public services, the economic, human and environmental impacts, to avoid that devastating impact that we saw last month. With one in 22 homes at risk and an environment scarred beyond repair, that cannot be allowed to happen. We need to act now, and the Scottish Government needs to lead and work constructively and collaboratively. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call Willie Rennie, around 6 minutes, Mr Rennie.
On Saturday afternoon, I met with residents in Auchtermuchty who had been subjected to quite significant floods. Their houses were dirty, they were damp, the smell was still pervading the whole premises. And that's the reality of flood. It's fast to arrive, but it's slow to leave. And I've also visited in recent weeks Fruki, where twice in the last 2 years residents have had to leave their properties. And there's one particular resident who can't sleep at night every time it rains for fear that her house is going to be flooded. At the weekend on Sunday, there was the high tides, which demolished a large part of the St Andrews Aquarium, the West Sands in St Andrews, and threatened homes in Pitt and Weem and Anstruther. And a large part of the coastal path near Ely was wiped away completely. This is the reality of climate change. If anybody had any doubt, it's here. No one single weather event can be directly attributed to it, but there's no doubt the frequency of these events and the extremity of them is quite significant. And if there was any doubt about it, inaction is more expensive than action itself. So we do need to look to the long term and provide the investment that we need, not just in mitigation, but also in meaningful climate change measures. Certainly.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr Rennie for giving way. Before he leaves the lessons of this particular weather incident, would Mr Rennie agree with me that part of what we have to understand is the enormous power and severity of the weather, which I know has affected the coastal communities of his constituency very dramatically, and scenes that some of us never thought we would experience. But understanding that severity and impact is critical to recognising the scale of the challenge that we face.
Mr Rennie, you can give me the time back.
And I think that understanding is important. It's something I'm going to come to later on, because with understanding, you get confidence that you're going to be safe. And I think we need to have the understanding too in order to plan for the future, to adapt much more significantly than we ever thought it was possible. I've never really witnessed such extreme weather events. Of course, there's individual events, but the frequency of them and the extreme nature of them is much more significant. Therefore, we need to revise our plans for the future. But one other lesson from the last few weeks has been the ability of the emergency services to respond. And there's no doubt they deserve huge credit for what they did in Angus and Aberdeenshire, Tayside and Perthshire. In extreme circumstances, they came together and they made a significant impact. But local authorities, their capacity to respond to this is really limited. I have witnessed many communities that just can't get through to the call centres, partly through the volume of the calls, but also through the limited capacity of the teams at the other end to respond to it, but also with the fire services, who are much more limited. And that's why we will support Labour's amendment today. But I think where John Swinney was right was the community resilience as well. Because if we have community resilience teams in areas that are able to have the expertise and the knowledge to be able to respond and work in partnership, they could act much more quickly than any emergency service. But if they've got the knowledge and understanding, they can assist in a way too. And Fraser Kutleski from Auchtermuchty, I have to say, call out, who's done a tremendous job over the last few weeks in supporting his neighbours. But we need more Frasers across the country to be able to make a real difference. But coming back to common understanding, I'm a strong supporter of farmers. They are great custodians of the land. They're the experts. They know how their land works, how it flows, how it's changed, where the water flows, where it doesn't, how they deal with all of that. We've got some brilliant advice, the best practice, research, guidance from various institutes. We've got funding in place for special schemes like Eddleston in the Borders, in the West Sands, in my constituency. We've got all those schemes. We've got agricultural support that support roundabout swales and reservoirs. But we need to have, I think, go a step further, because I'm not sure neighbours next to farmland really understand whether the land that's neighbouring their property has been properly managed and is adapting to the change that's coming that John Swinney has rightly highlighted. So I've received reports over the weekend about dredging in the River Eden. It's not been dredged significantly for some time. And the current view is that dredging is not in vogue and we should have a much more natural flowing river. But there is anxiety in the community that the lack of dredging is holding the water back up into the tributaries and is having an effect on the ability to the water to flow freely. Now, there is lots of expert advice on this, but the communities clearly don't understand that expert advice and they don't understand how it applies in their community. So I think an extra job needs to be done about getting a common understanding. Now, I'm leading some work in the village I grew up in, Strathmiglo, along these very lines, where I'm getting the farmers together with the council and various other authorities to get a common understanding about that, but also about rewilding as well in that community. But things like the potatoes, how are they sown in the field? If you go up and down the field rather than across, what difference does that make? Now, apparently, the machinery only allows it to go up and down. Now, neighbours get really concerned that the drills go up and down because they think the water's going to go right into their houses, and in some cases it has. Now, how do you deal with that? Do you grow potatoes next to certain properties? All of that needs to be properly explored, and I'm not sure it is, Mr. Swinney.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Rennie. I think Mr. Rennie's making a really important point here, but would you also extend it into the issue of forestry harvesting, where significant removal of trees, which is commonplace in many parts of Scotland, very significant in my constituency, it creates potentially new channels for water to go places much faster than it would normally go had the trees been there in the first place. So does that need to be strengthened in the forestry management approach?
Mr. Rennie, you do need to be winding up, please.
I've got so much more to say. But yeah, absolutely. The trees, riparian trees as well, is important to hold the banks together. Incredibly important to make sure we've got that understanding, but also making sure we adapt policy to reflect that. So all of that, I think, means that we do need to have a look at our policy and educate and inform and debate and discuss to make sure that neighbourhoods have confidence that the right plans are in place and the land is managed properly. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Kevin Stewart, around 6 minutes. Mr. Kerr.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. Storm Babbitt was a powerful reminder of the perilous position that many of our river and seaside communities in particular are in. We saw devastation at homes, businesses, farms and communities across Scotland. And in the northeast, in places like Petercooter, St Cyrus, Marykirk, Montrose, Monifieth, and of course Brechin, whose flood defences were simply swept aside as, and Maurice Golden statistics bear repeating here, the South Esk rose 4.4 metres above normal and 350 homes were evacuated. The North Esk Park settlement was evacuated and the lower North Water Bridge is still closed because of major erosion to its support. Now, I was struck, as I think we all were, by the bravery of our emergency services, the resilience of our communities and the response from our local authority officers in particular. But the Scottish Government's planning and preparedness for the scale of the flooding and the recovery has been found wanting. It's not like they weren't warned, given what Storm Frank brought to Ballater in December 2015, or when homes in Port Elphinstone and in Inverurie were evacuated a month later when the Don and the Eithen burst their banks, or just 2 years ago when Storm Arwen left tens of thousands without power amid winds of more than 100 miles an hour. And that is why the sheer complacency expressed in the government amendment, where it talks of establishing a ministerial task force and to engage on and develop a strategy, is breathtaking. Yes.
Kate Forbes.
I understandably hear the member's concern on behalf of constituents who faced a devastating situation. What does he suggest, and I mean this in genuine good faith, what does he suggest the interventions should be that make the biggest difference. I'll say in my own speech what has made a big difference in Dingwall. But in terms of Brechin, who could have envisaged 4 metre rises? That's quite remarkable.
Liam Kerr.
Well, I think we've already heard some really important solutions from the likes of Willie Rennie, the likes of Maurice Golden. But one of the key things, and this is the point that I was making to the Chamber and to Kate Forbes, is that actually we need to heed the warnings. Now, where I'm going with that is that I raised the issue of flooding and coastal erosion in Montrose shortly after my election in 2016. I worked with the council, the Montrose Links, the ports and others to help raise awareness and get action. There was a petition. There were parliamentary questions with soothing answers such as, and I quote, studies will be done. I even teamed up with former Lib Dem MSP. May I make some progress, Mrs. Swinney? I will try and come back. Like rumbles to invite the then Cabinet Secretary, Rosanna Cunningham, to see for herself. She declined, but we eventually persuaded her to a community meeting, and she heard from John Adams, the Links convener of Montrose, that either you spend £25 million now, or you spend £100 million in 5 years, or you put Montrose underwater. All the right noises were made. Something must be done. But it wasn't. Instead, the buck was passed to the underfunded, under-resourced Angus Council. Now, 6 years later, there was a £350,000 award from the Nature Restoration Fund for an options appraisal. But it turns out physical works will probably cost 10 times that in 2016 prices. Mr. Swinney.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Kerr for giving way. I don't want in any way to sour the tone of this debate, but I may end up doing so. But Mr. Kerr indicated that he believes there is a need and a necessity for action. But will Parliament forgive me for pointing out that when the government brings forward measures to try to tackle climate change, Mr. Kerr and his colleagues resist them? And there is no need, Mr. Kerr, shaking his head. I'd rather he addressed the point that I'm making.
Liam Kerr, give you the time.
I think I could address that point by simply saying that is, I'm afraid, John Swinney, that is absolute nonsense. And I say that from a position of authority as the former Shadow Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport. And as for the second part of the amendment's promise, to continue to engage with and support local mechanisms and bring together key partners, well, let's stay in Montrose, because at the beachfront there is devastation. There's a major breach in the sea defences opposite the Coast Guard station, which itself has been closed. Chunks of the promenade have collapsed, as is part of the road. The famous William Lamb minesweeper statue is at risk of falling into the sea. What was the Scottish Government's response? They dispatched Joe Fitzpatrick. Now, presiding officer, as people in the northeast have said to me, it is difficult to conceive of a problem to which the most immediate solution is send Joe Fitzpatrick. But in any event, far from bringing together key partners, he met with invited SNP councillors. Dedicated local councillors, democratically elected to serve the people of Montrose, Ian Gall and Tommy Stewart, were not invited. Now, people tell me that what they think concerns the SNP was less Montrose and more of a photo shoot. And if you need any evidence of that, look around the chamber for Joe Fitzpatrick now, because he ain't here. And ultimately, presiding officer, let's talk about how we go forward. The courier reports a repair bill of about £500 million. And the question the government needs to answer is, where is that coming from? Because Hamza Yousaf pledged support to Brechin after local councillors like Gavin Nicol demanded it. But he declined to say how much or when it will be available. Presiding officer, from Montrose to Monifieth, Ballater to Brechin, Peter Cooter to Port Elphinstone, the people of the North East have had enough. Scotland's local authorities are already looking at gaping holes in their budgets thanks to brutal SNP cuts, and they need support now for repairs and rehousing. This is not the first storm disaster we've faced, and it will not be the last. So this government must work collaboratively to build better local resilience and coordination to prepare for future extreme weather, as well as setting up local climate resilient funds. And above all, cease its complacency when it comes to storms and the North East. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Claire Baker. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And let me first take this opportunity to recognise the tragic impact of Storm Babette and I'd like to extend my sympathies to all of the families and communities that have been affected. And I'd also like to pay tribute to the first-class response by LRPs, councils, community groups, emergency responders and SEPA. And although both the Dee and the Don in my own constituency have flooded in recent years at Market Street in the harbour, on this occasion Aberdeen got off relatively lightly from Storm Babette. This is despite severe flooding only a few miles away from my own seat. I'll make some progress first of all. This pattern of storms that we are enduring is the reality of climate change. More violent and more focused rain, where one place gets hit hard, but next door is often missed. And climate change isn't just going to give us more rain. It's also going to give us less rain at other times. And a joined-up water management strategy is key. Flood defences are an important part of that, and I'm sure that others will speak to that, but a holistic Whole of Scotland approach is needed, with a focus not just on where the water ends up, but upstream in our fields, our hills and our mountains, where the rain falls. We need to restore our land's ability to hold, to slow down and to retain water. This dampens the effect of surging winter storms, but it also improves our water supply. And the Scottish Government has provided £500 million to the Just Transition for the North East Fund. And this is not only about transitioning to a net zero economy and ensuring our oil and gas industry can transition to renewable energy. A just transition is also about the two pillars of adaptation and resilience to climate change, as well as environmental protection and restoration. I'll take a brief intervention from Mr. Kerr.
Liam Kerr.
Very briefly, I don't actually disagree with the comments that Mr. Stewart's making, but just to point out, the government hasn't invested £500 million in the Just Transition Fund. It's only actually invested about £75 million
today. Kevin Stewart.
As Mr. Kerr well knows, the Just Transition Fund is £500 million over a decade. And we have invested in this early stages a number of things, and in this first few years, that includes work which has begun in Aberdeen, thanks to a £7.2 million award to the world-leading James Hutton Institute in Aberdeen to set up the Just Transition Hub. And the Just Transition Hub will be a world-class, state-of-the-art innovation hub, and it has the capacity to be a global centre of excellence. With funding from the government, the hub will place the North East scientific resources at the heart of innovation, nature-based solutions and a green recovery. And three of the hub's areas of work will be peatland restoration, carbon sequestration and flood management. And peatland restoration is critically important to dealing with the increased rainfall from climate change. And we took action in the last Planning Act around about peatland restoration. And I pay tribute to former member Claudia Beamish, who did a lot of work on that front with myself when I was planning minister. Peat is a giant sponge capable of absorbing huge amounts of water and then slowly releasing it again. And in the past, peat was more widespread, and restoring that peat will allow the land to absorb vast amounts of the rain that today simply rolls off the land, first into burns and streams and eventually into rivers, causing the flooding that we have seen. So peat restoration is one of the answers, as is also carbon sequestration. No, because I've got a lot more to say, Mr. Carson. Modern farming techniques, as Mr. Rennie and Mr. Swinney have already alluded to, have been vital in feeding the world's increasing population. But that has come at the cost of soil loss and soil degradation. And the degradation of our soils has been a major factor in increased flooding risk. As soils have got thinner and less rich, their ability to hold water has decreased, with water quickly running off into drainage ditches and then into rivers, carrying soil and crops with it. Carbon sequestration is about increasing the amount of organic matter in the soil, making our soils richer and more able to hold water and resist the ravages of rainfall. And with climate change, these land restoration strategies aren't going to be enough. There will still be flooding, and the Hub's work on flood management will be important too. We need to understand, Presiding Officer, Scotland field by field, and we need to know what can be done field by field in terms of land restoration and flood management. Now, our rural folk will know the James Hutton Institute well. It is the home of the Macaulay Land Capability for Agriculture system. The long-standing system maps every field and hillside in Scotland, including rainfall, the type of soil, the depth of the soil, the slope of the land, and the drainage. And by funding this team to develop the Just Transition Hub, we are building on the Hutton's expertise and knowledge of every field and burn in Scotland. We can do much more in ensuring a much better future for our country. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Karen Adam, around 6 minutes, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, Storm Babette brought huge damage across the country, and I pay tribute to the hard work of our emergency services and local communities in their response. I also send my condolences to those who have lost loved ones in terrible circumstances. It is clear to us that storms like these are increasing, and so the importance of proper investment in resilient infrastructure continues to grow. We must ensure we are better prepared and able to deal with them. The impacts of climate change are evident and are expected to worsen, and we must make sure we are prepared for extreme weather events to become more common. The reality of this is compounded by recent comments from the UK Committee on Climate Change, which underlines missed targets and, in their words, glaring gaps in the Scottish Government's climate plans. This has to be about the remedy and the cure. What we have seen in recent weeks and in similar events in recent years is that our current flood resilience and defences need to be bolstered. Part of that has to be ensuring that councils in areas affected and at risk are properly resourced to deal with these events. It also means investment in transport resilience, in infrastructure and in the frontline responders in our emergency services. Yesterday's members' business debate that Katie Clark led went some way to highlighting the importance of our fire service in protecting our communities, not just from fire, but also in response to events such as flooding. The rescue aspect of the fire service is vital to our response to extreme weather events, which can often lead to additional related incidents to respond to, such as traffic collisions and fires. The additional pressure put on our emergency services at these times is huge, and we must ensure they're able to respond as best they can. The way to ensure this is with adequate investment in the service, the workforce and the fire estate. The Scottish Government must heed the warnings from FBU that the service will continue to struggle to respond to extreme weather events without improved funding. In my region, Perth and Kinross was included in the red weather warning ahead of Storm Babette. Rail services were cancelled on a number of routes and people were advised to avoid travel where possible. The last time a red warning for rain was issued in Scotland was 2015, and it means that people have to take action to keep themselves and others safe from potential impacts. As these types of events increase, individual and community awareness of what to do in these situations becomes more important. And I have been heartened to read off the many examples of how local businesses, NHS staff, volunteers and others have gone above and beyond to help others through the worst of the weather. In the aftermath of the storm, Perthshire continues to experience days of rainfall and the closure of road and rail routes. The current priority is investigating the extent of the flooding and why it happened, where the longer-term work of repairing the damage begins. For the communities affected, the impacts will be wide-ranging. Communities and households have to be assured that infrastructure will be restored and that they will be supported to rebuild their lives, their businesses and their communities. But there have been other significant floods, and we have to ask whether enough has been done since then, and enough has been done from the lessons that should be learned. Because just a couple of years ago, in August 2020, torrential rain and stormy conditions wreaked havoc across large parts of Scotland. In Glenrothes, it was estimated that 20 million litres of water fell in a night. A landslide at Petticure Bay Holiday Park in Kinghorn saw around 200 people evacuated from their beds as caravans slid down the hillside, including 27 who had to be rescued by fire crews. Around 450 mobile homes at the park were at risk of sliding into each other. The same weather that year saw a number of staff vehicles parked at Victoria Hospital in Kirkcaldy submerged and carried by the flood, suffering extensive damage. Another landslip blocked part of the railway line and roads were closed because of flooding and potential collapses, with schools and nurseries closed. And Willie Rennie talked about the ongoing challenges in Fife, where we have many coastal communities, which makes us even further exposed. While the storms pass, the consequences for homes, businesses and communities can be long-reaching. For those displaced from their homes, for farmers dealing with flooding on their land, for transport routes and other local amenities, the time and financial investment needed to repair and rebuild can be huge. And we do need to ask whether our local authorities are in a position to be able to do so. There must be a strategic and a long-term approach adopted. We also need to ensure there is better planning, regulation and resilience preparation, including more investment in transport resilience. We need to see the review of existing and planned flood prevention schemes brought forward and look at how we can improve and accelerate flood resilience to protect our communities, homes and businesses. As the Cabinet Secretary knows, the Economy and Fair Work Committee did a recent inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area, and it highlighted some of the problems for local authorities in terms of the cost of flood defences. The proposed Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme is the largest flood defence project in Scotland and one of the biggest in the UK. And while Grangemouth has fortunately avoided significant flooding in recent years, it has high priority given the potential huge costs of an extreme flood event were to incur. The proposed final scheme is expected in 2024, but the scale of the scheme, at a cost of around £600 million, means the local council has expressed doubts over whether it can contribute 20% of that. So Falkirk's council predicament is of a significant scale, but local authorities across the country are having to increasingly plan a response to flooding. If they can have support to become more resilient, with adaptation investment being made available, the amount of money needed for any crisis response can be hopefully reduced, and the devastation that households and communities can be reduced, and the worst of what people have recently experienced can be avoided. Thank you, President Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Baker. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Around 6 minutes, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I firstly express my sincere condolences to those who lost loved ones during these recent storms? As a representative of the North East, I am deeply aware on a professional and personal level of the devastating impact that extreme weather events, such as Storm Babet and Storm Arwen before it, have had on our communities. One of the first major events as an MSP that I faced was when Storm Arwen hit in late 2021, and I had to make the decision as an office that we stopped work on everything else and just focused our efforts on solely helping those in the constituency affected by the storm. And what was most apparent is that the help that so many people wanted was actually to be supported to help others, to be signposted and have access to resources. So many individuals, businesses and community groups were reaching out to offer everything that they had. And whether that was a place to stay or a hot meal or transport to get to safety, for example, they pulled together to support the many people in need as the storm left thousands of homes across the northeast without power. And I put on record today my heartfelt thanks to all of those who showed us the best of humanity with their selfless acts in recent times. The way in which I saw communities, particularly on the ground in Banffshire and Buchan Coast, working together and supporting one another through that storm made me really ponder what resilience actually means in practice. Does it mean flood defences and electricity generators? Yes. But what it really extends to is empowering people on the ground to be resilient and supporting them as the first on the scene in many cases, as my colleague John Swinney mentioned earlier in his intervention. Presiding Officer, one of the most concerning issues that was brought to my attention by constituents during these storms was access to essentials. The bare supermarket shelves were a real worry, and last week in Chamber I raised this issue. We can see that these extreme weather events pose a threat to the marketplace itself, including the delayed arrival of everyday essential goods, and these disruptions can sometimes last for several days. Food security is one of the most pressing aspects of the extreme weather events, which are only going to get more frequent and more intense, and I would ask us all to prioritise this topic and embed it into all and any conversations on resilience. And it's not just the marketplace that we see this vulnerability in our food chain. These storms have directly affected agricultural yields, fish catches, and highlight the vulnerabilities within our food production systems. Flood power outages and crop spoilage all contribute significant risks to our food security. And as the Cabinet Secretary alluded to, there is no single storm that can be attributed to climate change. But we know, as I said earlier, the impending increase in strength of these extreme weather events presents a significant threat to our supply chains. Therefore, our efforts to build resilience must, of course, focus on mitigating the threats of floods and power outages to our food production sector in the first instance, which emphasises the pressing need to address climate change and its consequences. The motion that we are debating today is right to raise concerns of farming communities and highlight the particular impact the storms and floods have had on the North East. I would have liked, however, to have seen the motion go further in detail in a number of areas, and it goes without saying that we are, and I quote, concerned by the potential for more frequent and more intense extreme weather events fuelled by climate change. Perhaps, though, further detail on what climate action looks like for the Scottish Tories would have been a helpful addition.
Maurice Golden.
First of all, it's as basic as meeting the targets that the Scottish Government has set. You've failed 8 out of your last 12 emissions targets, Presiding Officer. You've failed on your recycling target for 2013. You've failed on your peatland restoration targets.
Please.
So I think, Presiding Officer, the Member should concentrate on meeting the targets, which we very much support.
Karen Adam, I can give you the time back.
Yeah, and that's the point. There's no action or support there to help deliver that. The last time I checked, the Conservative UK government has backed fracking for shale gas.
John Swinney.
I wonder if Ms Adam noticed as much as I did that in the intervention from Mr Golden, there was not a single solution offered to the challenge posed by Ms Adam in her original comments. Doesn't she think that's a matter of regret?
Karen Adam.
I absolutely do, and I thank John Swinney for that intervention, because my point was there was no detail as how to tackle it. They're all about the problems and never about the solutions, unless they're creating the problems. The last time I checked, the Conservative UK government has backed fracking for shale gas, reduced subsidies for solar energy, voted against more ambitious carbon emission reduction targets, provided financial support for fossil fuel projects, to name but a few, and it was a little over a month ago, too, that the Conservative Westminster government U-turned on its plan to ban new petrol and diesel cars by 2033, watered down its plan to phase out gas boilers, and scrapped the requirement for energy efficiency upgrades to homes. And on these rollbacks, I have to say, I do have respect for Maurice Golden, MSP, because he said, it's a regressive move that isn't only damaging environmentally, but economically and socially too. It drags net zero into the territory of culture wars. The way the changes were framed and delivered will polarise communities and create a binary environment where you're either for climate change initiatives or against them. And, Presiding Officer, I couldn't agree more with him. And I thank him for speaking up on that. The climate crisis we are facing and the communities most affected by flood that will become ever more common deserve better than petty culture wars. They deserve our unwavering support and commitment to tackle root causes of climate change and mitigations against the worst of the impacts. And I note the work of the Scottish Government, a £500 million Just Transition Fund, supporting a move to more sustainable and renewable energy. Crisis grants from the Scottish Welfare Fund, funding for the Scottish Flood Forum and flood protection schemes, the Scottish Climate Change Adaptation Programme, the National Flood Resilience Strategy, and a commitment to establish a ministerial task force to supplement the activities of local mechanisms. And these are just some examples of a clear indication of the Scottish Government's commitment. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I am by no means saying that we cannot go further, but the unwavering dedication by the Scottish Government to tackle climate change in the face of critical opposition is a very clear message to our young people, the future stewards of this planet, who we are all ultimately responsible for.
Thank you very much, Ms Adam. I now call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Storm Babet sadly received the first red warning in Scotland for 8 years. It was the wettest day on record in Angus since 1891. It ruined homes, damaged roads, destroyed infrastructure. Most tragically, it cost lives. And my thoughts and the thoughts of my colleagues are with those families who are in mourning. They must somehow cope with the grief from losing a loved one so soon. I'm also thinking about those people who have been displaced across Aberdeenshire, Angus, Dundee, Perthshire and Tayside. Some of them will not be back in their homes by Christmas. And I cannot imagine how difficult it must be to look at the devastation caused on your own home, your own town, your own community. This Parliament must give recovery efforts its full attention and not allow itself to become distracted by small, fair political issues, as has just been demonstrated.
Yeah, agreed.
This storm was extraordinary, but freak events like this are becoming more common as the climate changes. So the government's planning for events like this must also become more common. Attention cannot only turn to communities likely to be affected by adverse weather when disaster strikes. As others have articulated, more preparation needs to happen at an earlier stage. So when exceptional events do occur, the government is fully ready for them. So what can the government do? Flood defence plans and infrastructure investment plans must receive more focus. They should be updated annually to account for the ever-changing circumstances we face. The current infrastructure investment plan has earmarked £150 million for local authorities to spend on flood prevention schemes. So far, just £31 million of that has been allocated. Surely, this storm shows the pressing need for the rest of that funding to be accelerated. The government is working on a new flood resilience strategy. Of course, that is welcome. But the current timeline is for the final version to be published in autumn 2024, a year away. That seems a very long time to wait for something that is so essential. Had it been in place before Storm Babet, it would not have stopped the damage, but it may have helped limit it. Every week and month, waiting for the new strategy is potentially a lost opportunity to keep our community safe. The government must also use their wider budgets wisely and consider carefully which services they will need to rely on when the storm hits. Whenever an event like this happens, it is our police officers, our firefighters and our emergency services workers who also run towards danger and help to protect lives. Yep. If the government insists on going ahead with budget cuts, particularly to Scotland's police and fire services, how will they be able to respond as swiftly as they want to storms like this in the future? How will they have the capacity to go and help all the households in need? The answer is simple. If the SNP cuts their budgets, they won't be able to maintain the same standards of response to national emergencies. There will be greater risk to public safety. The SNP's ongoing cuts to council budgets must also be reconsidered and reversed. For more than a decade, local authorities have been told to do more with less by the government. Yes.
Craig Hoy.
Is she aware of the severe damage done to North Berwick's 400-year-old harbour wall this weekend when huge sea swells left behind a 5-metre trail of damage and destruction? And will she therefore join me in urging the Minister to free up emergency financial support for the clear-up and relief efforts rather than, as the Scottish Government does all too often, forcing our councils to fund these important repairs?
Rachel Hamilton.
Well, I totally agree with Craig Hoy, and obviously the harbour wall is an integral part of North Berwick, and the work that the Trust do, primarily by volunteers, is also incredibly important, and they should be supported not only from a safety point of view, but by this government in terms of preventing and investing in future issues with that particular wall. There's never been sustainable, but now it is now impossible for the funding I was talking about for councils across Perthshire, Tayside, Aberdeenshire and the North East that now must rebuild infrastructure and put more investment towards planning for future floods.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful for the opportunity to intervene. The member is right to narrate the exceptional work that our emergency services did throughout Babet, and of course we go into planning for next year's budget continuing to support them. But I wonder if she can reflect in all candour the impact that her colleagues in the UK government have had on the exceptionally difficult financial circumstances that we're in, not least through 14 years of austerity, a mishandled Brexit pursued in the middle of a pandemic, and an exceptionally mishandled pandemic at that.
Before calling Rachel Hamilton, we have exhausted whatever time we had available, so interventions will need to be brief from here on in. I can give you that time back, Ms Hamilton, but not an awful lot more.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sure Mary McCallum would like to reflect on 16 years of SNP austerity. The immediate priority must be to get people back into their homes and help communities to recover swiftly. During the Cabinet Secretary's statement last week, she repeatedly said that there would need to be an assessment of repair costs for both flood defences and rebuilding efforts. I'm keen to know what timescale the government is putting on those efforts, what assessments have already happened, and when will others take place. A tracker should be collected and published to ensure that these assessments happen swiftly in every community, and the government's efforts must be scrutinised. And one group, in closing, Presiding Officer, that have been overlooked is the farming community. They can be the solution to supporting the government's lack of effort over the preventative solution towards mitigating against future floods. They've sustained heavy losses, and RASB and Forage Aid have been fantastic in stepping up and picking in the pieces where this government did not intervene. But we must ensure, as John Swinney said, that their voices are also heard, particularly food producers, suppliers, and understanding the impact that this has had on food security. And they should be added to the Flood Resilience Partnership Review. I could go on, but I will close there. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Hamilton. As I said, before calling the next speaker, we have exhausted all time that we have available, so members will have to stick to the speaking allocations and accommodate any interventions within that. I call Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Christine Graham. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Storm Babette brought devastating consequences to communities up and down the North East. It is the latest extreme weather event that must be taken as a serious wake-up call for all of us elected to serve our communities. The climate emergency is here, and it is our responsibility to support measures that will address the impacts and mitigate the risks for people and our share of the planet. That the Conservatives have alighted on this issue for today's debate, however, smacks of hypocrisy. Let us not forget that this is the party that, a decade ago, vowed to cut the green crap, contributing to increased climate emissions and soaring energy prices, and just a matter of weeks ago scrapped its support for a raft of policies required to deliver on net zero. The Conservative Party is not fit to grapple with the climate challenges we face today, their anthropogenic causes, or the threats of tomorrow. According to Met Office statistics, Storm Babette brought the wettest day Angus has experienced on record since 1891. And this is part of an emerging trend. Four of the last 10 wettest days in the region occurred within the past 5 years. The Met Office is clear in its findings, and I quote, "These statistics are illustrative of the expected increases in rainfall extremes as the UK's climate continues to warm." That means more years where crops are destroyed in fields. People's homes are damaged, transport links disrupted, and most distressingly, lives lost. A party that has resolutely turned its back on the policies we badly need to deliver climate resilient infrastructure, emissions reduction, and nature-based solutions cannot be trusted to protect our communities from these threats. Others have outlined the work done by the Scottish Government, its agencies, and its local partners to develop flood prevention strategies and deliver public support. We must recognise and value the multi-level and cross-partner work already in place to tackle flooding and its aftermath. But it's clear we must also do more. As the National Flood Resilience Strategy is developed, I hope it will recognise that East Coast floods are different to those seen in the West. The differences in geology and watershed patterns require different mitigation methods be put in place. A standard approach Scotland-wide won't work. Brechin's defences were clearly not adequately future-proofed when constructed just a few years ago. It's now the time to review the processes that are in place for assessing the suitability of flood defences that currently exist. What the aftermath of Babet has also made clear is the importance of not only physical infrastructure and emergency response in times of disaster, but also the need for strong communities who can support each other in times of crisis, as Karen Adam has already discussed. Policies across government portfolios need to support community resilience, taking a holistic approach to placemaking through planning, health and local economic policies. Community groups such as Perth Community Food Aid are providing up-to-date flooding information to local residents and investing funds into local flood protection and water level monitoring. But there needs to be co-development of long-term strategies with such communities by local authorities and any cross-partner task forces that are established. Presiding Officer, I want to say a little about the need to bring in nature-based solutions to adapt our communities to heavy rainfall and flood flows. Flooding is a part of a natural cycle. It cannot be entirely prevented, but there is plenty more we can and must do to adapt our ways of living to safely manage the risk. Investing in a range of nature-based solutions can increase our resilience and diversify our approach to managing extreme weather. Catchment restoration, letting watercourses move freely, increasing vegetation along banks and removing old infrastructure such as weirs, increases the catchment's natural capacity to absorb excess water and reduce further risks downstream. Establishing wetlands, floodplains and woodlands can all act as natural buffers during storms, as well as increasing biodiversity throughout the year. Thriving coastal habitats and dune systems likewise mitigate against the impacts of tidal surges during extreme weather. This is why the Nature Restoration Fund is providing vital investment in locally led projects, such as the work by the Cairngorms National Park Authority to restore the Dee and Don catchments. This includes restoring the floodplain at Braemar, removing artificial embankments to establish new wetlands in the catchments. Funding has also been given to projects improving natural floodplains in Glen Clunie, Mar Lodge and at Tarland. Changes to wider land management practices are also needed to mitigate future flood risks. Peatlands can be vital upland buffers, with a healthy peat bog effectively acting as a sponge for excess rainfall. But when a peat bog is cut, drained, and its vegetation set alight, its ability to act as this natural flood defence is diminished, if not destroyed. That is why we must see control of burning of our muirlands and recognise the peatland's vital role in climate and nature emergency.
Member is about to conclude.
And encourage management measures that prioritise the health of peatlands. The reintroduction of the beaver has also been an important step in increasing our natural flood defences. Nature's engineers, this keystone species, plays an important role in adapting their environment in ways that manage flooding risks.
You do need to conclude, Ms. Chapman.
So these nature-based solutions can be implemented alongside some more traditional grey infrastructure, but we must ensure a balance of approach and that natural solutions are considered, in particular in upland areas, to mitigate consequences downstream. So
thank
I
you,
look
Ms.
forward
Chapman.
To the future discussions about the role of nature-based solutions in the development of the National Flood Resilience Strategy.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Katie Clark. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. To be subject to flooding, either at your home or business, is horrible and heartbreaking. The borders in past times, once dependent on the rivers and waterways to power the mills, has seen many parts of its communities flooded. I recall several incidents in my early days here when I visited homes in Hoyk, Selkirk, Stow and businesses in Gala, where all worldly goods were heaped outside in a sodden pile and the floors and cupboards of homes were warped by the floodwater and stopped damage beyond recovery. What images on the news cannot tell you is the stench that quickly follows the receding waters and in summer the invasions of flies. Borders learned the hard way how to deal, how to coordinate responses, and what preventative measures were needed and could be taken, both simple, such as accessing sandbags, monitoring electronically through sensors waterways, particularly upstream, and linking this data directly to fire and rescue as an early warning, and more fundamentally dealing with water flow upstream. And today, of course, the fallout that we reap from global warming adds pressures on communities living by waterways, in particular where more are vulnerable as flood risk areas spread. In an area, as I've said, whose historic economy was founded on the wool and weaving mills, where machines turn through the power of the river, though many of the mills have long gone, the risk from rivers and spate remains. But I am impressed with the systems in place by Scottish Borders Council, supplemented with Scottish Government funding for flood prevention schemes. I therefore consider that in the Borders, having developed skills and responses over decades, learning from bitter experience, and with excellent interagency emergency communication, there is no need for an additional bureaucratic layer. The Council already has a multi-agency functioning task force. For example, in the Borders, here are some of the Category 1 responders, including the Council, such as the police, fire, ambulance, health boards and integrated joint boards. And of course, there are several phases to an emergency. Prevention, and I'll speak about that later. Preparation with pre-warning. Much has improved with local detailed forecasts these days through the Met Office, enabling preparations such as where you can access sandbags, opening rest centres, or simply putting staff on standby in readiness to respond. Recovery. Floodwaters subside. Help and assistance have to be provided to the communities to get people back into their homes and to their businesses, clear up debris, signpost residents to funding and other support. Care for people is key in the event that floods manage to invade private and commercial properties. So in preparation, emergency accommodation must be in standby. You must be prepared to provide food, water and other necessities. Transport. Utilise the voluntary sector for assistance, Red Cross, Salvation Army, financial assistance and so on. Now, in my regard, much of this is already in place in the Scottish Borders, as I say, having learned over the decades from bitter experience. Several flood protection projects have also been completed or are planned for towns across the Borders, and these include in my constituency the Gala Shields Flood Prevention Scheme, completed in 2014. Next on the list is Peebles, Innerleithen, Broughton, Earlston, who are currently having flood studies to gain understanding of the flood mechanisms to appraise mitigation options. Upstream for Peebles, for example, mentioned by Willie Rennie, there's already functioning the Eddleston Water Project, which I visited several times, where the Eddleston Water, a tributary of the Tweed, has been reshaped to make its route wind more with planting of suitable vegetation at the water's edge, all to slow the water flow downstream into Peebles and to protect, in particular, the vulnerable Tweed Green, which is right at the banks of the Tweed. To date, as much has been successful, and I hope not to tempt the rain gods, but in Gala Shields on Bank Street, where shops and businesses were once flooded when upstream the tributaries burst their banks and flooded down the bay past the Volunteer Hall, this has been prevented through interventions and early warning alerts to agencies to unblock any blockages and their intervening and divert a build-up of water. Low-lying parts of Stow, which used to be flooded by Gala water, but its course and depth have also been altered, and so far all that's flooded is the park, protecting all properties and businesses roundabout. Now, these are just some examples where I've seen and visited flooded properties in the past and seen remedies which work. So much progress with local government taking the lead, supported by the Scottish Government and SEPA with funding, and with other national mechanisms for emergencies such as COBRA and the Scottish Resilience Room, I don't see a need for more bureaucracy. What works in the Scottish Borders could work elsewhere. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Kate Forbes. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And it's a pleasure to follow Christine Graham and the contribution she made about some of the positive work that's already going on. Today's debate on mitigating flooding impacts and increasing the resilience of communities is particularly important in light of Storm Babet. And I welcome the points made both by Maurice Golden and by Sarah Boyack in their opening contributions. As Claire Baker has said, three people tragically lost their lives in the storm, and I associate myself with the condolences which she sent. I also pay tribute to our emergency services, the affected communities and local authorities for their efforts in responding to the storm. Unfortunately, however, as Willie Rennie made very clear, this is unfortunately not a one-off extreme weather event. And the reality is that extreme weather events are becoming more common and are going to occur more frequently as the climate emergency worsens. This means we must be better prepared to deal with this changing climate. And the warnings from organisations such as the Climate Change Committee and Audit Scotland cannot be ignored, because they have been very clear about the lack of progress which is being made on climate adaptation measures. Last year, the Climate Change Committee warned that progress in delivering adaptation had actually stalled. They highlighted a lack of clear targets and monitoring to determine what progress is being made by the Scottish Government in terms of delivering climate adaptation measures. Audit Scotland also published a report back in April which highlighted that adaptation was an area where least progress was being made by Scottish ministers. Despite this Parliament declaring a climate emergency in 2019, it would appear that not only is the Scottish Government failing to make significant progress in meeting its own emission reduction targets, but it's also failing to deliver vital climate adaptation measures. As has been said, the Climate Change Committee and Audit Scotland made a number of recommendations, including the need for clearer adaptation targets and improved oversight of their delivery. And I would be grateful if the Minister could give an update today on whether these recommendations are now being acted upon. It has also been revealed that SEPA, Scottish Environment Protection Agency, has faced funding cuts of 26% in real terms since 2010. And two former SEPA chief executives have warned of the damaging impact that these funding cuts will have on the ability to protect Scotland's environment and respond to climate-related risks. I held a members' debate yesterday on the cuts being faced by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, which has had a 22% cut in real terms, that's £64 million in real terms over the last decade. 1,200 firefighter jobs have already been lost, and it is believed that a 780 further are threatened if the planned reductions in budgets go ahead, along with reductions perhaps of dozens of further appliances. The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, of course, has a statutory duty to make provisions for flooding, and the service has identified that the threat of flooding is going to become more frequent and severe in its climate change response plan. The service has also highlighted that 1 in 22 of all residential properties in Scotland are now at risk of flooding from rivers, the sea or heavy waterfall. They said that this places specialist resources like flooding response stations and swift water rescue units in greater risk of flooding. However, the Firestorm survey published last week by FBU Scotland found that 93% of fire brigade union members that were involved, that's about 1,500 members, took the view that the fire service was not adequately resourced to deal with the increase in climate-related incidents such as wildfires and flooding. That's why FBU Scotland is calling on the service to increase its capacity to deal with the predicted increases in incidents of flooding, along, of course, with an increase in incidents such as those that have been observed in Scotland over recent years with wildfires. As of the 20th of October, the Fire Service had responded to almost 70 weather-related incidents across Scotland, including rescues from homes and floodwaters as a result of Storm Babet. Ultimately, it's clear that we need to do more if we're going to respond to what is an increasing threat. And therefore, I repeat my call from yesterday and Scottish Labour's call for an emergency funding package for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to deal with the challenges that the climate emergency poses.
Thank you very much, Ms Clark. I now call Kate Forbes to be followed by Rona Mackay. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like many other members, I have communities in the Highlands that faced the challenges of severe flooding, not just once, but several times over the course of the last few weeks. But I actually want to start on a positive, because in previous years, there's another part of my constituency which has faced particularly severe flooding. And yet, this year, whilst there were threats and concerns, they didn't see the same level of extreme flooding that they have in previous years. I recall visiting a number of families in the town of Dingwall a few years ago who were absolutely devastated. We met in one of the affected families' homes. The entire house was ruined. There were no carpets, no floorboards. The water had flooded in. One lady described it as though it had bubbled through the floor and devastated their home. And they had been affected by flooding in the past, which had made it particularly difficult to get insurance. And so they were left high and dry by the latest flood. A few days ago, I visited a conservation biodiversity project, which is upstream of that very same river that in previous years had devastated families. And I met with two environmental consultants based near Dingwall who undertook last year a large-scale river restoration project. They had acquired funding through Nature Scots Nature Restoration Fund, and they had invested it in improving biodiversity upstream, and, critically, they had vested it in a slightly different way to reduce the risk of downstream flooding in Dingwall. The success of this project can be seen online. They produced a very short video of that work. But I was absolutely blown away, because too often there is a complete disconnect between our investment in environmental initiatives, our investment in reaching net zero, and the very pressing reality that faces families up and down the country. And yet this project, this initiative, revealed that in investing in biodiversity, in investing in conservation, in investing in ways that will avoid a flood risk downstream, they were completely transforming the lives of those families who I didn't have to visit a few weeks ago because they hadn't been flooded. Now, it's critical when we are looking at how to ensure this doesn't happen again that we think broad. I think the speeches across this afternoon have very adequately captured the level of devastation. And I could go on to talk about the families and the households and the businesses that were affected a few weeks ago in my constituency, in Aviemore, in Canusie, in the fact that communities were affected in Fort William and Malig on account of train services being off and public transport being off elsewhere. I can tell you about roads being shut between Salen and Kilchoen and closed elsewhere because of the risk of landslips. So I'm not in any way downplaying the absolute devastation that many saw a number of weeks ago. And I pay credit to council workers, council officers, local community groups, as well as some of our frontline responders in Network Rail, Police Scotland, SEPA and Scottish Water. They had to respond. But I think if anything is to come out of this most latest experience of devastation, whether it's in Brechin, in Aviemore, or in other communities that have been referenced, what we need to do is think differently. Because I heard a report the day after some of the worst flooding in Brechin, which said the thing is this, that if we build a wall that's 2 metres high, thinking that will stop the flooding, what happens when it's 3 metres high? And if we build something that's 3 metres high, what happens when it's 4 metres high? We could build something, a flood defence that is now over 4 metres high. But that is just responding by looking backwards. We need to think a lot more creatively and holistically. And that must include investment in biodiversity, investment in conservation, to deal with the root cause rather than just the symptoms. And so I close by paying credit to the families that have been affected greatly in the most recent flooding. I cannot begin to imagine the upheaval and the worry that they are currently enduring. But let us pay credit by ensuring it doesn't happen again. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Forbes. I now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is an important debate, and we've heard powerful and passionate speeches across the Chamber on the issue of support and mitigation of all too frequent flooding issues. Presiding Officer, extreme weather is something we're all having to cope with, not just in Scotland, but UK-wide and globally. The effect of climate change is well and truly here, and we are literally in the eye of the climate change storm. So we have to face up to that with practical and efficient solutions. And I found Kate Forbes' speech particularly fascinating with some of her contribution. The Scottish Government is taking action across agriculture, transport, forestry, water, industry and planning sectors to integrate flood resilience measures. And crucially, we're developing a national flood resilience strategy to tackle ongoing problems. And while no country can mitigate the risk of flooding entirely, the Scottish Government has committed an additional £150 million over the course of this Parliament to deliver improved flood resilience.
Liam Kerr, briefly.
I'm very grateful. As the member says, there's £150 million being allocated, but as I understand it, only £31 million has actually been put out. I'm finding it very difficult to find out where it's gone. Can the member enlighten me?
Rona Mackay.
In a word, no, but I'm quite sure that money is there, ready. Yes, I can't speak, I'm not in the government. But I'm confident that money is there ready to be put into use. Crucially, we're developing a national flood resilience strategy to tackle ongoing problems, because there's no doubt that measures must be put in place now to protect and prevent more catastrophe to our communities. It's been heartbreaking to see people lose everything as their homes are destroyed by filthy water, and to see landmarks like the harbour at North Berwick and many other places mentioned today just crumble under the pressure of the crashing waves. But in truth, in my constituency and where I live, 7 miles from Glasgow, we experience very little of the devastation colleagues have described. Very heavy rain, high winds and some flooding in low-lying areas was my experience, but no lasting damage that we've been hearing about this afternoon. That said, like in every community, there are certain areas with a long-standing problem of flooding in houses and the surrounding areas. An area in Bearsden South was particularly badly affected during Storm Babet, and the residents already suffering sky-high insurance quotes can't see light at the end of the tunnel. Presiding Officer, when people tragically die during these extreme weather episodes, as happened during Storm Babet, it is time for urgent action and resilience planning. And as has been said, the weather warnings from the Met Office, local authorities and politicians were accurate and timely, but nature is a force to be reckoned with. As the motion says, the efforts of the emergency services, local authorities and others to preserve life must be commended. And once again, we saw how much we rely on the professionalism and bravery of these services to support the most vulnerable and restore services as quickly as possible. The responsibility for development and delivery of flood protection schemes rests with individual local authorities who are best placed to respond to local resilience needs. Since 2008, the Scottish Government has made available £42 million per year to local authorities, and a commitment is in place for another £150 million, as I mentioned previously. And we're already developing a new flood resilience strategy for Scotland with communities at its heart. And throughout flood risk management and through the flood risk management plan, the efforts of all organisations that work to improve flood resilience are coordinated, helping us to target investment where it's most needed. A joint Scottish Government COSLA working group is considering funding arrangements for flood risk management actions going forward. So I think this answers the call for the multi-agency task force called for in the Conservative motion. We know that reducing flood risk will become even more crucial as climate change is expected to increase the frequency and severity of flooding across Scotland. For households, the Scottish Flood Forum can offer advice, information and support to help those flooded, including advice in managing insurance claims, drying your home, finding a builder and protecting your property from future flooding. Crisis grants are available through the Scottish Welfare Fund to families and people in Scotland on low incomes and have been hit by crisis such as floods. People can apply for a grant through their local authorities, as we heard the Minister outline. So help is at hand, and we must always plan ahead to mitigate and protect communities from the destructive force of climate change that we're currently experiencing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mackay. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by John Swinney. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Kerr.
Presiding Officer, I just want to begin by offering my thoughts and sympathies to everyone in Scotland who's been affected by flooding, the recent flooding. We've had quite a lot of flooding right across Scotland recently, and of course lives were lost, and I send my and add my condolences to those families who have been so cruelly and shockingly impacted. And I also would like to add my voice to those who have paid tribute to our first responders, to those who work in our local authorities, who put everything on the line to serve the communities that they live and work in. And I'm particularly mindful of the people that live in the vicinity of River Street in Brechin, because quite a few of the people that live in that street are seniors, and they have lost their homes, they have lost cherished possessions. Some of them will be out of their homes for some time, some of them may be out of their homes. In fact, some of them may not actually return to their homes. I learned that earlier today, and which is very sad. And I also would like to say that I'm really disappointed and surprised that, given the relevancy of this topic to the members of the people who live in my constituency, particularly in the Falkirk-Grangemouth area, that none of Falkirk's MSPs have come to the Chamber to listen to this debate. And I'm perhaps even more surprised that none of the Angus MSPs have come to the Chamber to listen to the debate, because I think it was a timely and appropriate issue for us to be discussing as a Scottish Parliament. And I think the people that live in those areas will be confused, as I am, as to why their representatives, their constituency representatives in particular, did not come to this debate. Now, climate change is a reality, and these changing weather patterns that we've been talking about are here to stay. I actually agree with what John Swinney said in his opening intervention in the debate. These are not really events now that can be easily categorised as exceptional. So, as a Parliament, there are two important lessons that we need to learn. There are some significant things that we need to take on board. The first is the need for improved flood defences in vulnerable areas. And I agree. I think Kate Forbes gave a very impressive speech on that subject, and I compliment her on that. The second issue is the need to increase the immediate support we offer those who have suffered from flooding. Now, Presiding Officer, Liam Kerr, I think, made the very important point that the SNP government apparently, clearly, in fact, I would say, were not better prepared to deal with these flood events. The communities and local authorities impacted by this recent storm should not have been left wondering if the Scottish Government was on hand to give them the necessary help that they needed. But that's the reality. I read the other day, for example, in the Courier, that Angus Council have had to take money from their reserves because they can't be sure, presumably, that they're going to have money available to them from the Scottish Government. Now, in my own constituency, the Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme is of local and national importance. And I'm very grateful to Claire Baker, who in her speech made the case very clearly in terms of the importance of this particular flood protection scheme. But since I became an MSP in 2021 for Centre Scotland, I have become increasingly frustrated at the snail's pace the project has been moving at. And the first hurdle is the debate about funding. Another one of these very difficult decisions that ministers get paid a lot of money to make around political priorities. And this, because the stark truth is that Falkirk Council cannot hope to fund a £700 million flood defence project. Asking the council to deliver this would essentially bankrupt the council. And bearing in mind the importance of Grangemouth to Scotland's national economy, can the minister please adopt a common sense position and state that the Scottish Government will fully fund that particular flood defence scheme? Yeah. Now, the second hurdle is that there is too much talking and not enough action. I was intrigued by the Cabinet Secretary's description of what the response of the government was in relation to the first Cabinet meeting after the flood had occurred, when what they did was set up a task force. And then, in response to the immediate needs of the people in Brechin, the Cabinet Secretary then went on to talk about how they could make applications to all these different bodies. Now, that's all well and good, but the people that lived on River Street don't need to be told that they need to go online to fill an application form in. Why is the Scottish Government not able to agree in that Cabinet meeting that a designated fund, an initial fund of money, would be made available to the people who are the victims of the flooding in Brechin? But instead, it's make an application online. That's really not what people want to hear. And I think when the people read about this debate, hopefully, in the Courier tomorrow, they will be astonished that that's as little as the government is prepared to concede when it comes to giving practical support. Well, time is running away from me, as usual. But there's just been... Thank you. But the second hurdle is that there's just too much talking and not enough action from the SNP government. Because what they do, and I'm glad that John Swinney agreed with that, because what they do is they go in a perpetual cycle of
if
reviews...
If you could conclude, please, Mr Kerr.
Reviews, consultations, published results, more consultations, more working groups, and nothing ever gets done. No nettles are ever grasped.
Thank you, Mr
Kerr. How well
Kerr.
Will that go down in Brechin?
Thank you, and I call John Swinney, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And there is a startling contrast between the considered contribution of Maurice Golden to open this debate, which I think has been a thoughtful rehearsing of serious issues, and the type of commentary we've just heard from Stephen Kerr, who said that nothing ever happens. Well, in 2002, when I had the privilege to represent the people of the city of Brechin, I walked through River Street and experienced the sorrow and the hardship that those individuals had faced, as I've faced in other parts of the constituencies I've had the privilege to represent over the years. And what happened as a response to that flood? Well, the government put up the money. The SNP government put up the money to build the flood defences in Brechin. So Mr Kerr has just been demonstrated to talk palpable nonsense to this Parliament this afternoon. And to make the miserable political speech about these issues that Mr Kerr has just made does no service to the people whose lives are turned upside down by flooding. I think, in my experience, that flooding is the most upsetting and distressing thing to people's lives other than bereavement, because it affects everything. Walking into houses where wedding photographs have been positioned in frames on the floor and they are ruined. These are moments that people never, ever forget. It inflicts trauma on people. So to present them in that fashion is, in my view, wholly unacceptable. I've seen in the course of these events significant impacts in my own constituency. Flooding of homes in Invergowrie, in the city of Perth, on Monday. I was visiting two families who live at the confluence of the River Isla and the River Erecht, who have been flooded on countless occasions in recent years when very robust flood banks that have been in place for many years have been overtopped by the severity, the extremity of the water courses that we are now experiencing. I've also stood with farmers, and I agree very much with the point that Willie Rennie made, who are trying their level best to grow crops in land which has always been able to be cultivated right up until December, but it wasn't this year, where they've lost crops. 42 acres of a field I stood in the other day there with the President of the National Farmers Union at Dowley, 42 acres utterly destroyed by flood water, with huge financial implications for that farmer. So there are new and more extreme circumstances. I visited another farm at Ballinlone near Trochry, near Dunkeld, on Friday, where the Ballinlone Burn, which is the most meandering little trickle down from the hills, is now a monster with huge land erosion. And what we need in that, and I'll be appealing to the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, is for some pragmatic thinking about how that farmer can restore the land in his farm, which will enable him to service his livestock and other projects on the farm, which is an essential necessity. And I'd be grateful if the Minister would give an encouragement to SEPA to engage pragmatically on these questions. Resilience is everybody's business. A flood incident is not just the responsibility of individuals or the council or the government, or the responder agencies. It's everybody's business, which is why I'm so grateful to resilience groups in my own constituency in Aylwith and Aberfeldy, who've had their fair share of flooding problems in the past. But the community has responded to those flooding incidents by developing the capacity and the capability to withstand flooding incidents. And in these very, very difficult conditions, Aberfeldy and Aylwith were largely able to be protected by the diligence and the activity and the energy of local volunteer groups. And I pay warm tribute to them. And I would ask the government to give consideration to whether very modest sums of money could be made available to support more of these community groups to establish more of that resilience capability. I'm sure Christine Graham will be familiar with it in her Borders constituency, to make sure that we can address these issues. Now, members have talked this afternoon, and I've made my contribution, on the extremity of the climate change issues that we face, which is why it was absolutely correct for my friend and colleague Karen Adam to make the blunt point to the Conservatives that it's all very well having a debate about flooding and coming here with complaints, but we all know it's coming as a result of climate change, so we've got to do something about it, and we've not got to put obstacles in the way of some of the measures that are necessary to tackle that. Now, I'll give way to Mr Kerr, since I've raised his contribution.
Yeah, Mr Swinney was the Finance Secretary for many years whilst I was campaigning to get the very obstacles that are required in Montrose. Precisely how much money did he, as Finance Secretary, give to do that reinforcement?
John Swinney.
What I would say to Mr Kerr is that there is a process of agreeing schemes between local authorities and the government, agreed through the Convention of the Scottish Local
Members.
Authorities, and Mr Kerr knows that as well as I do. So I'm going to close my contribution by returning helpfully to the question of money. Because in this debate today, the Conservatives have called for more money for local government, fire and police. They have got to waken up and smell the coffee. There is not a limitless sum of money, not since the destruction of the public finances by the Conservative Party. So, hard choices have got to be made. The government is prepared to make them, but we know the Conservatives are incapable of doing any of that on any occasion.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Mercedes Villalba.
Presiding Officer, we've heard today from Sarah Boyack of the real terms 22% cut to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service budget over the last 10 years. We've also heard how 15% of the workforce has been lost and another 780 jobs are currently at risk. In the face of our climate emergency, this is not sustainable. In just the first 2 days of Storm Babette, the service received more than 750 emergency calls and attended almost 300 incidents, including rescuing people from homes and vehicles. Our fire and rescue workers put themselves on the front line for us every day, yet they're having to fight for the fundamental resources they need to do their jobs. The Scottish Government may argue that the reduction in rescue workers shouldn't concern us, that the Government is reducing the risk to life from flooding in other ways, and even that these jobs are no longer necessary, but all the evidence suggests otherwise. Presiding Officer, as the Minister acknowledged in her statement last Wednesday, and as has been emphasised again today, our changing climate is bringing more extreme weather events with increasing risks of flooding. In 2015, SEPA described the event of 100 homes being flooded in the Brechin area as a 1 in 200 chance. But it happened just 8 years later. And in 2021, SEPA estimated that hundreds of homes and businesses in Brechin would be evacuated by floods in the 2080s due to climate change. But just 2 years later, hundreds of my constituents have had to be evacuated. Climate change is affecting our environment vastly more rapidly than we have been prepared for. And while we hear time and time again about the steps being taken to protect communities, clearly, they're not enough. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government might argue that it aims to tackle the risk of flooding at source by tackling climate change. We heard from Rona Mackay how we're in the eye of the storm of climate change. We know that climate change is global and that the effects are likely to cascade, triggering more and more extreme events like Storm Babette at home and across the world. But dramatic action and leadership still has the potential to make a huge difference. So we cannot afford to keep missing our emissions targets. Yes, we're over halfway to net zero, but our emissions reductions have been slower than planned, despite the significant drop in travel during the pandemic. That means Scotland is continuing to contribute to climate disasters, both at home and globally, with little sign of them reducing any time soon. The decisions we make here impact people everywhere because our climate is connected. We must act now to risk endangering more lives. The good news is, Presiding Officer, we're not powerless to save our climate, and there are lessons from nature that we can learn. We heard from Maggie Chapman about natural flood management solutions. These can be hugely effective and offer a way to increase resilience while also meeting biodiversity, carbon capture, and other environmental goals. Willie Rennie spoke about the benefits of riparian woodlands, which can slow river flows, cool water temperatures, improve water quality, and increase biodiversity. And our abundant peatlands can act as a natural sponge to prevent rainfall in higher areas overflowing rivers downstream. That's why it's so concerning that the Scottish Government has missed its woodland creation targets for the last 5 years, and that 80% of our peatland is in a degraded state, and that the Scottish Government has missed its target for peatland restoration for 5 years in a row. Presiding Officer, today we've heard how targets to reduce climate change are not being met, how targets to create woodland are not being met, how targets to restore peatland are not being met. We've heard how the government has failed to report on flood risk management plans, how it's failed to adequately fund our fire and rescue service, and how this has all failed communities like Brechin. So we know the problems we're facing from climate change. They're well documented. And we know the solutions needed for climate adaptation. They're within reach. What we're lacking is a government willing and able to rise to that challenge.
Thank you. And I call on Mary McCallum to wind up.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much to all members who have contributed to today's debate. I think we've had some positive contributions. Firstly, I would like to welcome how consistently members across the chamber put right at the forefront of their remarks the individuals and the families who have been so much affected by Storm Babet, of course, but equally earlier storms in October. I think that that's absolutely right, that they should be at the forefront of our minds and of our remarks. I also was very keen to stress the need for collaboration in my contribution, and I was really pleased to have that echoed back by a number of members in their contributions. I stress that because we need collaboration. This matter, driven by climate change and our responsibility to respond to, it has to go beyond party politics. The people who are suffering, who we've all included in our remarks, they require that of us. In particular, there was a theme that emerged a number of times. Yes, of course.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful and genuinely in that spirit. The question I posed to Rona Mackay, can the Minister tell me which local authorities has the £31 million from the Infrastructure Investment Plan gone to, and in what proportions, or can she tell me where I can find it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, absolutely. So the £150 million, which of course is on top of the £40 million per annum, has been allocated to the Local Authority Capital Grant and is agreed on an annual basis according to distribution. And I can tell them that in 22-23, £21 million was allocated. I don't have the distribution between local authorities in front of me just now. I shall be glad to provide it to him in writing. What I was going to go on to reflect on was a theme that had come up from a number of members' contributions that I particularly appreciate, and that is flood risk management as a whole catchment practice. I think Willie Rennie raised this really fulsomely in the context of food production and the impacts that he's seen from flooding in his constituency. He mentioned dredging. He questioned whether it was in vogue or not. Respectfully, I don't think it's a case of that. I think it's a case of close examination on a case-by-case basis of whether or not it's appropriate. And of course, experts at SEPA can do that when applications are made. And I say that in an entirely neutral way. We just need to assess it on a case-by-case basis. John Swinney contributed to that by mentioning forestry and how important forestry is, being a dominant land use in Scotland and having an impact on water table management. He's absolutely right to do that. Kevin Stewart and Mercedes Villalba, she also mentioned peatlands and how vital restored... I will in a second. How important restored peatlands are to managing the water table and to offering that equilibrium in the water table.
Tess White.
Thank you to the Minister for taking that intervention on peatlands. In 2018, the Scottish Minister, SNP Minister, said that the government would restore 20,000 hectares of peatland as part of the Climate Action Plan. Yet, the latest figure, as of today, is only 7,000.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not sure there was a question in that comment, Presiding Officer, but I'm very pleased to make two points in response to it. Firstly, we've set aside £250 million over a number of years because we recognise the importance of restoring peatlands. It is an industry in its infancy, however, and we are turning all of our minds to how we can go from building it from an industry in its infancy to one that is the natural thing for landowners to do, and we'll keep working on that. I just wanted to close on the point of whole catchment management, but I think Maggie Chapman narrated it really well. Christine Graham was absolutely right to mention the Eddleston Water Project, which I've been able to visit myself. And I really appreciated Kate Forbes' very practical example of how the impacts of that can be positive for people in their communities. Another positive contribution, I think, was from Karen Adam, who was absolutely right to stress how in times of difficulty Scotland's communities are often at their very best. I should want to see them able to avoid the need to do that, but there's no doubt in my mind from my interaction with them that that has absolutely been the case. I do have to say that I regret the attempts, principally by Conservative members, to politicise this event. I hope that they know that as they criticise the response across Scotland, Hundreds of workers across Scotland are listening to their criticisms and will be taking it very hard indeed, I would imagine, because I said we need collaboration. We do
Let's
not
Let's hear the Cabinet Secretary.
Politicisation. Thanks, Presiding Officer. Liam Kerr used the phrase found wanting without going on to substantiate in any meaningful way the extent to which that was the case. And I'm not even going to waste time narrating anything of what Stephen Kerr said, because it was so baseless and unhelpful, particularly in the face of a really serious issue which is affecting people up and down the country. And of course, Mr. Swinney was right to point out the irony that the Tories have failed to support action on climate change time and time again. Just on the point about Montrose, Liam Kerr is absolutely right to mention that that's an important adaptation issue. And he spoke of his experience in 2019. Well, in my short time alone in this role, I have continued to seek to develop the Dynamic Coast Project, assessing movement of our coastline. I've worked to try and distribute funds from that new £12 million capital grant for coastal adaptation. I have visited Montrose Port Authority. I have been taken up and down the water to see the erosion for myself. And I've offered to chair a meeting with Montrose Port Authority, with the Council and with others to see that we can shortcut solutions and make progress in that regard. Presiding Officer, I'm really conscious that I am...
Point of order, Presiding Officer.
Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
I don't want to take away from your rulings, Presiding Officer, but I've been trying to listen very carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary has been saying here, and all I can hear is Mr Kerr shouting sanctimonious. There is nobody more sanctimonious than Mr Kerr, in my humble opinion. But I would really like to hear what the Cabinet Secretary has to say.
Mr Stewart, you will be aware of the fact that it is the case that members are required to respect the authority of the chair. The person in the chair is best placed to decide where and when to intervene. I have already asked members to ensure that we can hear the Cabinet Secretary and indeed any member who has the right to be on their feet one at a time, I would suggest, would be a very, very good way of focusing on that for all members. And I would, of course, remind all members of the need at all times to treat one another with courtesy and respect. If you'd like to continue, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm conscious that time's against me and I don't want to eat into other members' time. I just wanted to use what I have left to stress the fact that in that strategic forward look, as well as all those immediate operational interventions that we've made, we are undertaking that strategic forward look. And of course, that includes working with SEPA to reassess on an ongoing basis, continually challenging ourselves to reassess flood risk in the light of climate change, which is exacerbating it, and which, of course, we have to continue to adapt to. And responses on that front, I will be seeking through the new Scottish Government task force to deal with recovery phase. But just a final thought, Presiding Officer, John Swinney stressed the devastation of flooding, the seriousness of it, and the serious approach that is needed to manage it. And I just want to close by saying that Scottish Government stand with our affected communities with all the seriousness and the commitment that's required.
Thank you. And I call on Tess White to wind up the debate. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My heart goes out to the people in Brechin and the North East affected by Storm Babet, especially to those families who have lost their homes and their loved ones. And just before I begin, Mr Stewart, what a waste of a point of order for a cheap political point, pot, kettle. And I'd like to thank those in the gallery who've come today from Brechin to hear what the SNP Green Government is doing to help right here and right now. They want to hear, and that's why they've come today. Yeah. So many North East residents listened to Angela Constance last week in dismay and disbelief. Here was the Home Affairs Secretary hailing the SNP's forthcoming flood resilience strategy, not even published, which will look ahead to 2045. This crystal ball approach is more than wearing thin. Communities in Angus, Aberdeenshire and Dundee just want to know what's happening to help them get back on their feet. And I say to Mr. Swinney and Miss McCallan, yes, people are listening today. Yeah. The Breakiners were told by former SNP Environment Secretary Rosanna Cunningham that the town's £16.3 million flood prevention scheme would protect them for generations to come. Generations to come.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just as regards the flood events, I just wonder if the member will acknowledge, as others have, that these were built to withstand a 1-in-200-year event, and that points out how exceptional the rainfall event was with Storm Babet, and equally how much that latter point I was making about SEPA considering changes is important. And the final point I just wish she would acknowledge is that even though it was compromised, it provided vital time to allow people to evacuate, and I hope she'll thank the workers who were involved in that.
Thanks, White. Thank you for that question. I come later in my speech to Stonehaven and the huge difference between what happened in Stonehaven and what happened in Brechin. And I'd just like to refer to Ms Forbes' comment that if it's 2 feet, it needs to be 3 feet. So I would challenge that intervention. 7 years later than that comment was made about generations to come, 7 years later, the town was in the eye of Storm Babet. Flood waters raged through River Street and beyond, destroying homes and endangering lives and livelihoods. The farming community, who sustained huge losses, and residents don't want words. They don't want rehashed rhetoric, and they don't want recycled policy pledges from this SNP Green government. They want to know what happened. They want to know why it happened and how it can be fixed. Yeah. They want to see leadership. But the SNP Green government doesn't have a coherent plan in place on how they will help these communities recover. Council budgets cannot stretch to provide the financial support needed. Funds from the Belwyn scheme, once they're mobilised, are welcome, but won't touch the sides of what's required. And local authority areas have already had to cut so much cloth because year-on-year cuts to their general revenue budgets by the SNP government. In Angus, there were reports of sandbag rationing, with homes and businesses having just as little as two per property, as we've heard today, to keep out 2 months' worth of rain. This led to some... It led to a grey market with people selling sandbags on social media, something that shouldn't be happening if a council is properly prepared and properly funded. Angus Council has pledged £250,000 of its rapidly disappearing general fund to help with the aftermath. But when it's gone, it's gone. Yeah. Yeah. And this is just a small drop in the ocean of what's needed in the days and weeks ahead. In Brechin, I was shocked by the widespread damage and devastation. I saw locals distraught as they tried to salvage what they could from their homes. Two elderly people, one with a chest infection, returned to a damp flat with mud, and it wasn't just mud, because we all know what's in the mud, still on the floors. They had a dehumidifier churning away, but had little impact on the damp, the smell, and the decay. A home sweet home sign was discarded on the street, with other ruined household items for the council to collect. Children's fridge magnets stuck in the pavement mud, and the pathos not lost on those walking past. The heart-wrenching human cost of Storm Babet has been considerable. The financial cost will run into tens of millions of pounds. And homeowners who do have insurance have been speaking to assessors and feeling like they're on a merry-go-round of phone calls and frustration. Others haven't got insurance because the flood risk and the sky-high premiums, because insurers didn't account that £16 million flood defence would protect the residents, and they can't afford to refurbish or rebuild. And one resident whose ground floor was completely flooded told me she had no contact from Angus Council before or after the storm. Unfortunately, her power didn't cut out, because if she wasn't online at the time, she would not have known to evacuate her property, and it was dangerous. What happened was dangerous, she said. Other residents have issued desperate pleas to dredge the river in targeted areas, questioning whether measures to protect marine life are having an impact on human life. As Councillor Gavin Nicol, who's here today, has urged, environmental protection should take a back seat when human cost is so high. And some also question the water and landscape management further up the glens and the role of SEPA, which has taken a long time to get back to full functioning after the serious cyber attack 3 years ago. Katie Clark today talked about the huge funding cuts to SEPA. And in the gallery today, the people in the gallery and watching will see that the questions on peatlands in its infancy, peatland management is thousands of years old. And I was really disappointed, and I'm glad that the people of Brechin could see in the opening speech from the minister, she didn't even take a single intervention. Well, she did. She took it from her own side. And that is another example of the SNP battening down the hatches. And another ministerial task force? Really, Miss Adam? Another ministerial task force? A hurdle is, as Stephen Kerr pointed out, and that is a case in point. There is too much talking and not enough action. Does that sound familiar? We've had a review, then a consultation, then results are published, then reports gather dust. The process repeats itself. More taxpayers' money washed away. No nettles grasped. Mary McCallan says she's absolutely committed to learning. And why don't we believe her? I would actually say get on with it. Questions have arisen too about why Stonehaven's newer flood defence is held when Brechin's were overtopped. The climate change allowance, factoring in changes in peak river flow, and I do hope you'll listen, Miss McCallan, rather than talking, because this is the point that I'm actually coming back on your question, talking to your colleague, sorry, presiding officer. The climate change allowance, in answer to your question, factoring in changes in peak river flow and rainfall intensity, is a key consideration. I understand that Stonehaven's allowance is higher than Brechin's, and that's a result of updates to guidance from SEPA and Stonehaven's newer scheme. As work gets underway to repair Brechin's flood defences, it's vital that they are future-proofed. 7 years is a short shelf life for a £16 million project that was designed to provide a 1 in 200 years standard of defence. And there are lessons here for other flood defence schemes across Scotland. We do need innovative thinking. Presiding officer, our councils are woefully underfunded, while the SNP government is poorly prepared for adverse weather events like these. And one of my colleagues said today that this SNP government couldn't run a bath. I say to Mr. Swinney, this SNP government is throwing millions at reserve matters, foreign embassies, doomed legal cases, a botched census, and failing ferries. Maurice Golden highlighted that this was one of the costliest weather events in Scottish history, with a repair bill that could hit £500 million. And in closing, presiding officer, the farmers, the people of Brechin and the North East need to know that this SNP government has not forgotten them. The SNP constituency MSP, Mary Goujon, was MIA, seeming to only appear for photo ops with her boss. Presiding officer, the people of Brechin want to feel safe and protected in their homes. We've got a long way to go before they do. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on supporting communities to mitigate flooding impacts and increase resilience. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11045 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11045 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motions 11046 on stage one timetable for a bill and 11047 on a stage two timetable for a bill. And I ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button. And I call on George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motions.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motions. Therefore, the question is that motions 11046 and 11047 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 11048 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. And I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
And then, Presiding Officer, moved.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that Amendment 11036.2 in the name of Mary McCallan, which seeks to amend Motion 11036 in the name of Maurice Golden on supporting communities to mitigate flooding impacts and increased resilience, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.